Based on the recent discussions in the past few months about Meltdown and Spectre, the security issues, here's now my presentation about how to read privileged memory with a side channel. First, I will introduce you to the concept of the branch prediction, which is important in that respect. Then I will show you how a modern computer works and specifically a processor. And based on that, I can explain you in a more detailed way how Meltdown and Spectre are working. First, to the concept about the concept of branch prediction. Let's imagine you are responsible for a trail junction at around 1800, and your job is, well, if you hear a train coming, you come out of your house, you stop the train, you ask the driver where he wants to go, and then based on this, you put the junction either to the left or to the right, and then the slow train slowly starts driving and moving on its way, and all takes very long, and so you wonder if there's a faster way. And then you decide that you are keeping track about where the past trains were going, and then based on this, you can make a prediction. For example, here you might see a pattern in it, and then predict that the next train will most likely go to the left. So you put the junction to the left, and if you are right, then the train, without stopping, can just go on its way. And if you guessed wrong, then maybe the train already drove in the wrong direction and then has to stop and then has to drive a little bit backwards and tell you that you made an error and you have to fix it, and then the slow train can start driving again. But if you guess right each time, then everything will just go a lot faster. And then please keep this whole thing in mind, because this is how a processor works. If you have a branch, like an if-else condition, then while the processor waits for its data, it makes a prediction about which branch will be executed and then already executes the data before it is clear if it is right or not. So now a brief overview about modern computer architecture. Here's just the basics. Here we have some input devices like the mouse or the keyboard. We have some output devices like a screen or a printer. We have some external storage, for example, a hard drive. We have the memory, also called RAM, so random access memory. And we have those CPU, or also called processor, which does the calculation. And because it's all is so abst is very abstract, I like to make it more visual. So I would say the external storage, it is like a library for books. There's a huge amount of space to store data, but it may takes a while to retrieve them, and there are all the books stored you are currently not working with. Then the memory is like a desk. There are the books placed you are currently working with. And from the CPU, the arithmetic unit, this is what basically does the calculations. Now I'd like to introduce you to the concept of physical and virtual memory. For the hard drive, the physical memory, that is what is, no, not for the hard drive, sorry, for the memory, the physical memory is what it's really there, what's really there in the computer as physical memory. But for a process, the operating system creates new addresses or uses other addresses which belong to the virtual memory. The operating system keeps track about which virtual addresses belong to which physical addresses, and that, for instance, can be used for a process to tell the process that it has way more memory than it actually does, and if it wants to access some data not currently mapped to physical memory, like switching the page of a book, the operating system can just load the data. So the process doesn't notice that it doesn't have that much memory. And as you might see here, in the virtual memory, there is some dedicated space for the operating system where it maps its kernel memory. So it can use that memory to which it needs for the process to operate. And then, as I said in the for the branch prediction, the processor pipeline is like a stream of instructions, and there might be instructions that take very long. For instance, it might take a while until the value of A is read. So the processor might change the order of the instructions. In this case, based on the branch prediction, it might predict that this conditional shall be executed. So it will start reading B before it knows if the condition is true or not. Now, Spectre manipulates the branch prediction history, and it does so by training, but I don't want to go into too much detail here. And it then makes that the prediction for this branch where the condition is false or will be false. But because it manipulated the branch history, the processor will predict that the branch is true and then will execute the commands in it. So I try to drew it a bit down here. So let's imagine this is part of the virtual memory. On the left side of those big line, that is the memory belonging to the process. That's the process where some program is running that uses some Spectre code that uses a Spectre vulnerability. So let's just call it the Spectre process. So this is running here. It has this blue array with some data in it. This doesn't really matter. Then it has here those green array, which is really short. And then, as you can see here, those offset, which is actually, as you can see, it's way outside of the green array. But the branch is now falsely predicted by the processor to become true. So the processor will start to execute the commands in it. And what this does is that it reads data from the green array. So the Spectre process says that those orange value is part of the green array, but so you see that it is not. So this value is red, and then the process uses this value that was read from here to access an element from this array. So for instance, if in those orange field there is maybe a zero, then maybe the first element of those array will be exist which has the index 0. And at this point, there's no access control, so it is not checked if the Spectre process is allowed to access those data. But the processor thinks that it doesn't matter, because if it's wrong, then the data is thrown away anyway. So now, because this field was cached, this field was access, this element was access, it is stored in the cache of the processor, so it can access those elements faster. So now the real processing got to the branch, and the processor notes that the prediction was false, but it doesn't really matter. All this processing it did, all those calculations, all this, so it values it retrieved, it's just thrown away. So the processor was reverted back in a state before the branch, but yeah, so the Spectre process doesn't get to know which value has been read from the field, which is not allowed to see. But the reading had some side effects, which I visualized here with those thinking bubble. So now, after the branch, the Spectre process now reads data from each element in those blue array. And then it measures the time it takes before it gets the value of those elements. And then one value will be retrieved fast, way much faster than the others. And because it has been cached before. And now it doesn't really matter which value is in here, but based on which element is the fastest, the Spectre process then knows which value has been in the orange field. So for instance, if from the blue array the first element is the fastest, then it means that the value in the orange field is a 0. So if the first element is the fastest, then the Spectre knows that this field contains a 0. If the second element is the fastest, then it knows that here is the 1, because the second element has the index 1. So, and then Spectre can just repeat the whole process. Now Spectre knows which value is here, but Spectre can then repeat the whole process to read out any value in any other process. So that's the way it can get all the memory of the other processes. So now Meltdown works very similar. It also uses those speculative execution, but it uses the out-of-order execution. For instance, in this example code, it's not really an example, it's just the idea how it can look. Here's some method. This method has a lot of dependencies, so it needs to wait for a lot of data that is loaded from somewhere in the system. And at the end, this method will throw an exception. And then, but after those lines, there's the other command that accesses data where the Meltdown process is actually not allowed to read, but it's not checked at this moment. So, and then this one throughs the exception, which Meltdown can either catch, it has to handle some in some way, or it can It can perform this whole thing in a trial process. But then it's very similar to Spectre. After this has been executed and the data has been thrown away because this is never reached, then Meltdown can, based on which of its data returns fastest, it knows which value has been there where it's not allowed to read any data. Now I have some videos for you about Meltdown in action. Here's where Meltdown creates a dump of the whole memory. On those left side, it's the plain values, and on the right side, it's in human readable form. And in a second, here's Meltdown used to read out some password from another process. This slows down my system. Here's Meltdown used to reconstruct an image. And here Meltdown reconstructs a photo, which the user doesn't see anymore because they already closed the file, but it's still in the memory, so Meltdown can read it from there. Here I have some Meltdown and Spectre comparison. So Meltdown has been spotted only in Intel processors, while Spectre affects all processors. Then Meltdown compromits the separation between operating system and user layer, so it can read the complete memory, not only the one dedicated to processes, but also from the operating system that maps its memory to the process. Spectre only works in the user layer, and it can, well, only read memory from other processes, but there's a POC, an example of Spectre in JavaScript, so for instance the other process might be another tab in the browser. For Meltdown there's a fix called Kaiser, and I think it's a KPTI or something like this called nowadays. So Meltdown is basically fixed. For Spectre I found different information. So from Spectre there are two versions, and the first versions I read from many software manufacturers that they have fixed it, and as far as I heard the second variation is not fixed, so it's still an open problem. And there's also the question, well, as you saw, these two issues, they use the processor workings, and the processors work that way because this makes the computer way much faster. So one fellow worker estimated that without those processing, our computers would be as slow as in the 90s. So, and Meltdown and Spectre, they might be just two examples from the whole class of security vulnerabilities which work similar to them. So this is still an open problem, and there's research going on about this. And that what they have in common is that they are using those speculative execution, which, as I said, is performed by the processors to speed the whole thing up. They use side effects that are occurring, which are not reverted. And they use the fact that access rights are not checked at that point, because that would also slow down the whole processing. Yeah, if you have any questions, feel free to write them in the comments. And then, if not, thank you for your attention. Here are some of my references. Here are more references. And here are some pages where I just took pictures from. So, thank you very much.